Because of my research, I'd like to talk about the driving forces and the motivation which pushed me towards the conducting of this kind of research. Well, in the domain of science, it has been known for several years that there is a strong relationship between the urban built environment and the quality of urban climate and climate change. As we all know, many functions in cities consume energies, and this energy consumption gives some outputs which we call greenhouse gas emissions, and these greenhouse gas emissions changes two things. One is the urban climate, which we can feel in everyday life, and the second one is the climate change, which is a global scale concept which is already accepted by scientists as a fact and also accepted by most of the governments as an issue to be solved in the short and the long run. And if we conceptualize cities like multifunctional sectors, as you can see from in the table in the right side, different sectors have different kind of productions. For instance, building sector needs energy for heating or cooling facilities. Transportation sector, we need again energy for running the transportation networks. And all this kind of energy consumption releases a certain amount of carbon and greenhouse gases. And when we look at the distribution of the energy consumption in Turkey, as you can see from the pie chart, building and services uses 37% of the total amount of the energy consumed in the urban area. This is a very important ratio, and if you look at the following rates, industry and transportation, you can say that building and services plus transportation, which are two basic components of our urban daily life, constitutes more than 50% of the energy consumption in urban spaces. And this is why nowadays both scientists and also governments try to find some solutions to reduce the energy consumption in urban spaces. And Turkey agreed many of the agreements related to climate change, many international agreements, and I'd like to read one extract from a declaration which is by Fatma Güldem Etseri, ex-Minister of Environment and Urbanization. She was the minister when I was doing my research. She's saying that it is necessary to achieve changes in production processes in the fields of energy, urbanization and transportation. Unfortunately, countries couldn't cover a substantial distance since the Kyoto Protocol. And we are full of hope for countries to take particular responsibilities at the 2015 Paris Climate Conference. Turkey declared its target of 21% reduction in greenhouse gas emissions by 2030. As we can see, there is a full of hope in the national level to do something regarding reducing the energy consumption in urban space. And the biggest achievement in Turkey, which is done so far, is the National Climate Change Action Plan. And the National Climate Change Action Plan actually says energy efficiency is the most important strategy to reduce the energy consumption in urban environments. I'd like to give you an example from the housing sector. For instance, the chart below shows the distribution of domestic energy consumption. As you can see, most of the energy used in houses goes to thermal comfort, almost half of the energy consumed in indoor spaces. And this is the distribution doesn't vary from developing countries to developed countries. As we can see, almost in all countries, half of the energy is consumed for heating and cooling, for provision of thermal comfort. And the interesting thing is that the energy efficiency report says that Turkey has a potential to save up to 35% in the housing sector and up to 15% in the transportation sector to save energy. And this actually gives us an open area to find some solutions to reduce the energy consumption both in housing and transportation. And there's a big amount of literature about how to reduce the energy consumption in urban space, and I would like to present these indicators with a simplification, with a classification which starts from the architectural scale and goes through street, neighborhood, and city scale. And if we look at the table, all these indicators are related to our everyday life experiences. For instance, when we think about our everyday life experience in transportation or in public spaces like green spaces, presence of a green area in the city affects the cooling of the whole city as a thermal comfort parameter. Or when we look at the architectural scale, orientation of the building and the amount of solar amount of sun that the house gets from the windows, or the material that is used for the construction of the housing affects the amount of energy that we use in the houses to provide thermal comfort. For instance, if you have a better insulation in your house, you probably reduce less energy to heat your house during the winter. And scientists developed different approaches to produce more climate cities. There are approaches called like transit-oriented development, which proposes use of more public transportation to consume less energy in our everyday commuting patterns, or climate responsive design, which is emerged in the field of architecture, and some many others. My stance and my argument regarding this universal principle is this. I really appreciate the amount of information and the technical knowledge that is produced in the literature, but I argue that universal solutions and the technical knowledge generated and accumulated in the literature is not enough to solve local level, local contextual problems. Let me give you an example. For instance, transit-oriented development proposed use of more public transportation. And let's imagine that we propose use of transit-oriented development for an Arabic country like Abu Dhabi, where the private car ownership is a symbol of prestige in society. I'm afraid it's not going to work in the short run, also in the long run, because transit-oriented development says that you have to use public transportation and you should live in small houses like 60 square meters, you should consume less. It is not realistic to accept a society to change radically, especially if they are used to consume more energy or they are used to use like more private cars or used to live in larger houses for many years. So what I'm trying to say is there should be a balanced way while producing information about how to develop our cities. And my approach to climate responsive urban design is a socio-technical approach which focuses on the technical dimension of the problem as well as the social dimension of the problem, because I believe that this is a problem that can be solved by local people and with knowledge that is generated by and through the local people's experiences. And if we concentrate on what climate responsive design says in the literature, it has two goals. One is the minimization of the energy consumed in the urban environment, and the second one is the maximization of the comfort level in the urban daily life. And to achieve the first goal, minimization of energy consumption, there is two channels. One is the use of technological solutions, and the second one is the getting maximum benefit that we can get from the natural resources in a way to reduce the use of fossil fuels for the energies. But when it comes to the second goal of climate responsive design, which is the maximizing comfort level, this is very much related to human experience and lifestyle, because comfort is a very individual term which is attached to the way people live in the built environment and their lifestyles. So this is why I again would like to underline the importance of creating a socio-technical approach to design our future cities. So what I am trying to do during my research. I wanted to answer whether we can redefine urban design in a way to respond first to local climatic conditions, and second is to local lifestyles, people's perceptions, and requirements for the provision of urban thermal comfort in urban life. And to do this, I've used urban heritage site as an open lab. And the urban heritage site in Mardin actually provided me an opportunity, because the development in the urban heritage site was done thousands of years ago, and it was constructed based on the human experience. There was no technology by that time. Actually, technology developed up after the experiences that is built in the built environment. So this shows us some clues about being responsive to urban climate, even when we don't have technology in urban life. And to conduct my research, I used Mardin, and I have designed a comparative research in Mardin. But before going to details of the research, let me introduce you to Mardin, if there's someone who doesn't know where Mardin is and what kind of a climate Mardin has. As you can see from the map, Mardin is located in the southeastern part of the country, and there's a really harsh climate, especially for the summers. The temperature goes up to 35 degrees. Of course, these values are taken from the meteorological institution, so these values show the temperature in shadow. The maximum temperature that I measured was 55 in August on the site. So you can imagine the level of the problem of thermal comfort, especially in the summers in the city. As I said, I have designed the research as a comparative case study between the old town and the new town. And you can see the old town, the heritage site, has a compact urban pattern on the southern part of the city, and it is developed on the slope of a hill. And the new town spreads over the valley. And two towns present totally different urban patterns. The old town has a horizontal development, mainly composed of terraced houses with courtyards and terraces and some open space extensions. And while the new town presents more vertical developments, mainly composed of high-rise apartment blocks that we can see in any city of Turkey, disregarding the local conditions. And while doing my research, two questions come up to my mind. One is how the morphology of the built environment in the old and the new town was formulated, because there is a big difference within the same locality. And the second one is how the built environment within the old and the new town were in response to climatic conditions, and also the way people live in the urban settings. And yeah, this was a long process. It was not easy to understand how the people live in the built environment and how they are affected by the formation of the built environment. So I designed my research in 3 years. First of all, I had no idea about the Mardin and the society and the way people live in there. So I had to conduct a pilot study to first see how people use the built environment, how they provide thermal comfort in their everyday life, and how much energy they consume to do it. And then after doing the pilot study, I went back to the main research, and I conducted some different techniques in the area, which is supporting my socio-technical approach. And this allowed me to understand the local reality of the Mardin space. And I'll give some details about how I conducted the research. I can divide it into two stages. In the first stage, I wanted to understand the indoor space experiences and architectural space experiences. To do this, I conducted an architectural comfort comparison between the vernacular housing units and contemporary apartment flats. This comparison includes in-depth interviews and also technical measurements regarding how the temperature values changes both indoor spaces and also outdoor spaces such as terraces, courtyards, or the balconies of the contemporary apartment flats. So basically, I put some data loggers to measure the temperature and humidity values simultaneously. And while I'm decoding these values, I also conducted in-depth interviews to understand how local people adapt to local climate or to what level they can adapt to harsh climate in Mardin. And in the second stage, to understand the outdoor thermal comfort experiences, again, I've done a comparative study between two sample streets which present same characteristics. I mean, there was only one vehicle street, so it was the only option for me to choose, and I tried to find the one which is close, which has the same land uses on it. And there, I had no more option to compare, so it was the only option that I could compare. But the thing is that the height weight ratio of the streets were quite similar to each other, but the directions of the streets was not similar. So it gave me the opportunity to understand the orientation of the street in terms of the thermal comfort in the outer spaces. Well, like in the architectural scale, I did a thermal comfort questionnaire with 600 people, 600 pedestrians, and I did some measurements too. Well, I found really interesting results. First of all, housing design makes significant difference in the perceived thermal comfort. Before explaining the results, how I define the thermal comfort in a house, it's a combination of three assets. One is the design of the house itself, it affects the comfort experience. And the second is the external devices that people use for provision of thermal comfort. And the last one is users' adaptive capacity, which is something very individual. And the housing design attributes that I've used in the research, you can see in the list, there are eight attributes. Typology of the house, whether it's the courtyarded house or whether it's an apartment flat. Material of the construction, size of the house, orientation towards the sun, floor numbers, number of rooms in the house, number of open space extensions such as courtyards, terraces, or dam, we call in Turkish, or balconies in contemporary flats, and the location of service zones such as bathroom and toilet. This was a significant variable because in the old town the location of service zones are outside of the house because during that period there were no infrastructure at all in the area. And to understand which housing design attributes explain the difference between two towns, I conducted a discriminative analysis by using some multivariate statistical techniques. I did some analysis and I'm not going to give the details of the statistical things, but the outcome is that typology, orientation, number of open space extensions, and locational service zones are significant variables that affects the thermal comfort experience in the old and new town. And after this analysis, I wanted to see up to which level these housing design parameters affects individual level experiences. So I've done two different segregation analysis in the old town and the new town. And it is interesting to see that in the old town, in the vernacular architecture, you can see from the first table, number of rooms, number of open space and typology in total explains up to 35% that the level of thermal comfort that they provide in their houses. And the number of open spaces has the greatest ratio with 30%. When it comes to the contemporary apartment land, unfortunately there is not a strong relationship between the design of the house and the comfort level. Only 7% is explained by the number of the rooms, which is very weak and very insignificant value for statistical analysis. So what these courtyards and open space expansions provide for local people? I was interested to see and explore why people were so comfortable and happy with their open space extensions. First of all, courtyards provide safe and comfortable space for children. As you can see from this extract from an interview, she says, courtyard is like a joking place that we can use for different purposes. As you see, during the summer, it is convenient for my children to play in the inflatable pool. During the evenings, we usually have our dinner in the courtyard. It also allows for drying of laundry and desiccation of food. So you can see that many facilities can be done more comfortable environment in courtyards. It also provides a comfortable place for socializing. That's me and my research assistant in the field while we were doing interviews. So it was a very comfortable environment for us to conduct the interviews. And it also provides opportunity for cooling. You see a lady here holding the courtyard, and with the effect of evaporation, it creates a cooling effect in the courtyard, and you feel more cool. And also it influences mental and physical well-being. And there's a striking extract from the interview again, and he says, a 75 years old male says, I would prefer to die rather than move to one of those high-rise cage blocks in the town. Look at this lovely courtyard. I'm able to see the sky, I'm able to breathe fresh air whenever I want. So we can see that this is not only about what you feel in terms of temperature, but it is also about how you feel the urban space that you are living in. And also terraces has the same kind of activities. People get benefit of sun, and in a way they save energy, for instance, for drying the laundries, or they produce some collective products, which is a kind of like socializing for women in the area. Again, an extract says, it is our tradition to prepare dry food for the coming winter with our neighbors. This is like a ritual. You can't find this connection in the town. People even don't care who their next door neighbor is. So we can see that people are being pushed towards a different type of lifestyle with these apartment blocks, and people doesn't want to move to the new town. And what else? Cooler nighttime experience. It was really interesting to see special beds, which is designed for sleeping in the terraces. Again, without any air conditioning, with natural cooling, they have better nighttime experience. And also, terraces provide space for alternative functions. Again, a swimming pool. Usually, I see that children play in the courtyards or terraces. And also, you can see the dried food, which gets the benefit of sun. And again, turning back to some technical information that I collected from the field. Supporting the in-depth interview results, the comparison of recorded temperature values also says there is a big difference in the indoor and outdoor temperatures of a traditional vernacular architecture and a contemporary apartment flat. As you can follow from the table, while there is a difference, a 6-degree difference between indoor space and courtyard of a vernacular housing unit, this difference is almost 3 degrees in a contemporary apartment flat. So this shows that even the outdoor temperature is the same, what is experienced in the inside is quite different depending on the material of the house. And this gives the average, average ratios, but there are some like more striking examples, like for instance at 11 a.m. in the morning, while the temperature in the courtyard with the effect of sun is measured as 51 degrees, indoor temperature is 29 in the vernacular architecture, but simultaneously temperature in the balcony was recorded 42 degrees, while the indoor temperature of the contemporary flat was 32 degrees, which is still higher than indoor temperature of a vernacular unit. And of course, this affects the use of air conditioner and the ratio of using air conditioners between the old town and the new town. as you can see from the charts, constant use of air conditioner in the new town is 70%, while this ratio goes 12% in the old town, because there are some other ways to provide thermal comfort in the old town. And the interview and the survey results also support this. As you can see the distribution on the left side, this shows the general evaluation of thermal comfort in housing units. And most of the respondents from old town accumulates towards cooler side, while the responses from new town accumulates toward more warm or hot side of the chart. And after seeing the importance of using a high amount of air conditioners in the city, I was interested to see what is the role of external cooling devices to provide room thermal comfort in indoor spaces. So I conducted some regression analysis to understand their roles, and analysis shows again a number of electric fans and number of air conditioners can explain the variation in thermal comfort up to 25%. And the distribution in the bottom shows there are some houses in the new town where householders have three air conditioners, two electric fans in one single housing unit. This is an extreme level of energy consumption for providing thermal comfort in one single unit, housing unit. And this extract actually shows the level of dependency in the new town. He says, the air conditioners are lifesaver. Without cooling the house, it is impossible to stay at home, particularly when we have more people in the house. When we are alone, my children are almost naked. Imagine when we host our guests, you can't even drink a cup of tea if I close the air conditioner. And he was joking, would you like to experience it? And I did actually in another house. And during the interview, there was an electricity cut, and this happens very often because there's a huge problem of infrastructure in the city. The municipal level of infrastructure is not strong enough to supply this kind of energy and electricity demand in the city. And you can see from my research diary, which was a part of my research technique again, I have understood very well what an air conditioner means for those who are living in the town. The electricity cut during the interviews was a terrible experience. The room became like a sauna in 10 minutes, and we were drinking tea, because we had to in a way, because this was a part of Mardin hospitality. And the landlady tried to make us feel more comfortable, but actually we were there to experience this kind of everyday life experiences. And related with the air conditioner usage, I have calculated the amount of energy consumption in two towns, and the result says that the energy consumed for air conditioners in the new town is doubled compared to the old town. And as you can see from the facades of the houses, apartment units, all of the units are covered by the engines of the air conditioners. And actually this creates a circular relationship between the use of air conditioners and the urban heat, which is triggered by these engines. Because of engines, not only the engines of air conditioners, all kinds of engines in the city, there is a specific amount of heat in urban areas. So if you go outside of the city, you can feel the temperature differences. And this urban heat actually triggers more requirements for air conditioner in the indoor spaces. And the worst thing is that people are not aware of this condition, or even if they are aware of this condition, there's nothing they can do if they are living in these contemporary apartment houses. When it comes to outdoor thermal comfort, again, following the same principles, I did the comparison between the new town and the old town. And these content groups are extracted from the in-depth interviews. I asked people the attributes that make them to feel more comfortable in outdoor spaces. So, as you can see, shading and landscaping has the greatest ratio, which is not very surprising for Mardin, for such a harsh, hot climate. And I wanted to understand which perceived attributes. So these attributes on the left are identified by the respondents. So I wanted to understand how which attributes at the street scale explain the difference between two towns. So how they vary from old town to new town. And the difference between two towns can be explained with vegetation, separated walkway, urban furniture, and pavement. This is the statistical result. But as I said, it is not true, or it's not correct to trust statistical results itself. Again, turning back to the in-depth interviews, we can see the connections between the statistical results and what is said in the interviews. For instance, people are complaining about why the municipality doesn't plant trees in the new town, or people are complaining about not being able to walk in the asphalt because of the feeling that they feel there is something like an engine under the asphalt which gives more hot climate to their faces. An extract from a 70 years old female again saying that it is really hard for her to walk in the top, walk in the new town since there is walk in the old town since there are not enough urban furnitures, and it is not easy for her to walk for long distance under this kind of hot climate, so she requires like urban furniture to stop and rest under some shadowy areas. So this kind of requirements from local people. And to validate the data that I collected from interviews, I have conducted street surveys to understand how the streetscape between the two streets that I showed in the previous slide affects the felt perceived comfort on the streets. So I asked people to rate their sensations the moment that I asked them the question. The first question was about their thermal sensation and how they feel the temperature on the date that I'm doing the survey. And you can see from the graph that most of the people in the new town voted for hot, while the responses in the old town clustered towards the warm side of the diagram. And about being exposure to sun, there is not much difference because in Mardin, sun is everywhere, so you can't escape from the sun except the specific narrow points in the city that you can hide yourself while you are commuting in the city. And same for the wind sensation, there is not much difference because there was no wind at all, so most of the people voted for just right. And then humidity sensation. Again, Mardin has a really hot, Mardin has a really dry climate, so in an individual level, it was not easy to expect to feel the level of humidity. For instance, when you go to the Black Sea region, you can easily say that, okay, I feel more humid here compared to Ankara or compared to Mardin. But since the climate is very dry, there was not much difference between two towns. And in the end of the street survey, overall thermal comfort comparison, again we see a small shift towards the uncomfortable side in the new town, but it is not correct to say that new town is uncomfortable and old town is comfortable. There are some different attributes that provide comfortable comfort level in the old town, and of course some weaknesses in the old town too. And these two photographs are very sharp, striking actually. I'm not sure if you can see it. It's a little bit dark. It's better here. And as you can see on the left side, people, a local woman, due to their religious beliefs and their dressing styles, have more difficulty compared to men. So most of the people, most of the female respondents said that they don't prefer to go out before 6 or 7 p.m. This is a very big problem in the city. So most women feel like stuck in the house because of sun. And as you can see from the extract, one woman says, there's no way for me to go to the supermarket on food during the day. It is already a big problem to walk in this heat, and I can't imagine myself walking under the sun with shopping bags. This is why I usually wait for my husband to come and collect me by car after his work. When he is not available, I try to go on foot after 6 or 7 p.m. and try to buy the minimum amount of stuff that I urgently need. So even the supermarket is very close to the house, they prefer to use cars, which is obvious because they need more comfortable commuting patterns. And when we look at the general layout of the city and the general plan of the city, during the interviews I wanted to highlight respond to highlight the attributes that makes them to feel comfortable in their city level experiences. And these six categories: accessibility without sun exposure, braving outdoor spaces, building density, children and elderly friendliness, green space, and accessibility urban services became like major content groups which are important for local people. And unfortunately, New Town has only one common green space, only one single park, which you can see on the picture. And this one interview again says, we come to this park almost every late afternoon. We don't want to be stuck in the house, sitting in front of TV under the air conditioner. My children are able to move the way that they want here. In the house, we cannot even move to not to sleep. Imagine children, they are more active than us, and they need to run, play, and have fun. So this excerpt shows the level of discomfort, the level of uncomfortable experience that people are having in their houses, and the requirement of more open space and green space in the new town. Again, another extract from the new town: look at the distance between buildings. Opening the window doesn't provide any slight breeze. It doesn't help for cooling the room. The apartment is totally blocked by two sides. I can almost reach my neighbor's balcony from my living room. Shouldn't be there a rule for a minimum distance between buildings? Of course, there are some rules in constructing houses, but when it comes to the control and the construction and implementation levels, it doesn't work as it is written in the rules and regulations. And my argument and my observation is this: the lack of green space or breathing space, in a way it is defined by respondents in the town, is related to planning decisions which determine the building or construction density in town. Also floor area ratios, building coverage ratio, and amount of green space per individual while doing the urban plan of the city. And you can see the examples from neighborhood, both developed by subcontractors and also the housing, the National Housing Administration of Turkey. As you remember in the beginning of the presentation, there is an argument saying that they want to create more green cities and reduce energy consumption. And this is like an outcome of what is done by Turkey. And after seeing what is the existing condition in Mardin New Town, I wanted to talk to planner officials to understand their reaction and their perception about how they are going to plan the future of the city. And I was quite surprised when I learned that the municipality has the vision of creating an eco-city in the Mardin. At first I thought that it was brilliant to learn that they are going to build an eco-city, but unfortunately an eco-city without any green space is like a joke. And this is the plan that they have prepared for the next planning period. And I'll just give an example of a building block. You can see four apartment blocks. Each one has 10 stories. Maybe you can't read 10 stories. So they're almost like same level of apartments for the whole city. So this is one single block layout. And if you imagine the city layout, which is going to be like on the bottom side, the city and the valley will be full of high-rise apartment blocks with the same level, and there will be an urban layer on top of these apartment blocks, which will eliminate this air circulation in the city. So what I'm trying to say is, an alternative proposal would be like playing with the heights and the volumes of the blocks and create more air circulation in a valley, such kind of a flat valley like Mardin Neatime settled. So I'm not trying to say that this is the best solution to do it, but what I'm trying to highlight is there are some alternative ways of developing urban built environment, even within using the existing rules and regulations. So we don't have to reinvent the rules and regulations from the beginning. And here are some examples from international cases. For instance, the one on the left is from Italy. Of course, this cannot be implemented in Mardin case, but I'm trying to show you that there are some also other different kinds of vertical developments. So this concept introduces vertical forest, which creates like natural cooling and which creates natural corridors for cooling in the city. It is open to discussion whether this is a sustainable solution or not, because there should be perhaps there will occur some irrigation problem or maintenance problem in the future. But again, an alternative scenario for the future. And the other one on the right side is from Singapore. Again, very hot and humid climate. And the concept introduces blending the nature, design, and community together. As you can see from the shape and the form of the building masses, they are trying to open wind corridors by using a V shape. And they try to open these channels towards different directions because in winter conditions, these wind corridors can create discomfort. So it is like a balanced solution for winter and summer conditions for the Singapore local, in local context. When I come to conclusion again, I would like to read you another extract from the minister again. She's saying this time, "We entered into a new era in which we aim to reduce the carbon emissions. As the Ministry of Environment and Urbanization, we aim to encourage the use of renewable energy technologies and development of environment-friendly green buildings. We will give preference to horizontal approaches rather than vertical development models. Turkey embodies very rich cultural and social diversities. Therefore, our new modern development should maintain the richness. With this purpose, we believe that the horizontal development concept can provide the continuation of our neighboring relations, more livable urban spaces with full of green areas in which families and children comfortably live." Sounds great, isn't it? And what we see in the practicality, these are some examples from government-led developments. I'm not saying that the national level of declarations or the agreements which are signed for decreasing the energy consumption in the international and national levels. I'm not saying that I don't trust them, but still there is too much to do in the practical level and we need to get on action. And there should be some action in the local level because we develop our cities in the local level. And before ending my talk, I wanted to put this extract because this was very shocking for me, because I was trying to understand the expectations of local people and I was asking them how we can design the new town by using the variables and indicators that they wanted to extract from the old town and their old experiences in the vernacular architecture. And one lady said me that, "Why should we try to be more modern, honey?" Because when I asked her about how to reflect these findings to the modern development, she has reacted to me like in a defensive way, saying that we are comfortable and happy enough in our existing primitive living environment. Because she wanted to say me that the way that I approach them actually gives the feeling of them that they are living in a primitive environment. I can understand them, and I was really surprised that the local level, means the local authority, Valilik, has 60 registered donkeys in the city for using the facilities like garbage collection in these narrow streets in the town. And this is extract from the interview actually gives a really good understanding of the way people live in the area. Because what is developed in the new town pushes people to consume more, and consumption both in terms of energy and also changing the lifestyles that is that has been already going on for several years in the area. So I turned myself and asked the question, why we are trying to design cities by trying to call them like responsive cities, but they don't respond at all, neither to local climate conditions or the lifestyle of the local people. And I think that this will be a good opening for the discussion for tonight. I'd like to thank you, and I want to end my presentation with this quotation. Don't forget the past, learn from it. Don't remain limited, build a better mousetrap. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Anlı, for your vision and approach to climate change and your contribution to science and for sharing this this work with us. I really would like to really open the floor to the audience for comments and questions, but before that I would like to thank you for coming here tonight. Perhaps this is the most uncomfortable day of this winter, minus one. It's a cold weather for us, so thank you so much for coming and taking the time to be here. Just perhaps a few words before opening the discussion to the audience. Usually climate change is perceived as a global issue that we follow through numbers and values, and you really brought that to the people level and show that what people do or do not do impact the environment and global change, and based on the comfort boundaries, which is a very basic thing, we impact the environment and shape the environment by reproducing irresponsive or not irresponsive, unresponsive to the climatic conditions. And it is very much related to our lives, our culture that we produce in that environment and our relationship with the place. So this was very interesting. So please raise your questions to and comments.
And thank you very much. That was really enlightening and very interesting talk. I have two questions. The first one is actually we saw a story about the summer. Mm-hmm. But what about the winter? Because knowing from some people that have stayed in the old city, it is a tough winter in the old city. So I imagine that elements that in the summer might be actually very nice, very comfortable actually, having the bathroom outside, perfect, no smell. In the winter time, this might create problem. And I think in the scale that you presented of a perception of the issue, cold in the old city was extremely high. Mm-hmm. So I was wondering what is the case if this research was done or if you did actually part of the research for the winter. Mm-hmm. And the second question is, so we see all these kind of hopeful declarations by the government or like stakeholders, but what about the regulations themselves? Is there a concept of like climate comfort inside the regulation? Is there something that when you talk to the stakeholders you could refer to and contrast to all this development of Toki-style skyscrapers? Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Okay, shall I take the questions or shall I just respond?
I think it's better to respond.
For your first question, the initial idea was conducting this research for the winter conditions too. And the interviews were started actually to understand the winter conditions. But the thing about the winter condition, the regression result doesn't give a significant output when I use the design variables with the winter. The only significant output was the locational service zones. And it seems like the only reason for people moving from old town to new town is the location of the service zones. Because if there is a really old grandmother in the house, for instance, since it becomes difficult for them to use the service zones, they prefer to move to the new town. And the interesting thing is, that is something that I didn't say, more than half of the people, the respondents that I have talked, had two houses, one in the old town and one in the new town. And it is interesting because people use old town as summer place because of the difficulties in the winter. But this difficulty is, as I said, with infrastructure and also the amount of snow in the town. Because snow creates walkability problems. Because there is no transportation in the old town, everything is pedestrianized, all streets are pedestrianized except one, the one that I use for comparison, and the rest is pedestrianized. So the reasons from moving old town to new town is this kind of problems. And for the second thing, yes, we have regulations and rules in the planning world, but there is no, of course, specific rules about thermal comfort, but what I have talked about here is related with the urban planning in general. It's not only about the urban comfort. For instance, we have regulations for energy efficiency in the buildings, also regulations for giving enough green areas per individuals. There are like some standards for providing green space in urban built environment, but the thing is that there are some challenges in the implementation. For instance, ownership pattern of the land is, it seems, one of the biggest challenges in Mardin. Since the private ownership of land is really high in Mardin, the planners in the municipal office say they are really struggling with finding or opening green space area, common green space, due to the lack of land, due to the lack of public land. And when it comes to negotiate with local people, of course everyone tries to increase their maximum benefit of construction. But this is again, points out the necessity of approaching people and local people, because this is not like an expert-based process. Urban planning is a process that we should negotiate with local people, because they are the people who are suffering from living in this harsh climate. So everyone should take a part, and everyone should join the knowledge generation process of urban planning in Mardin. This is what I think the only way of solution for the future. For instance, convincing people to give a small portion from their lands to create more common spaces requires some different techniques rather than the current urban development system. Because nowadays, the plan of Mardin, for instance, is produced by a special company, Ankara. They have no idea about the local problems. Well, probably they are doing some analysis in the city, but the people who are working on the project are not from Mardin, and they don't know the local context as much as the people who are living there.
Are there any questions or comments? I would also like to say thank you very much for a very interesting lecture. And if you say that you would like to give more possibilities for planning on the local level, does the legal framework for that exist?
It exists. For instance, if you want to conduct a participatory planning process and invite all the stakeholders and also inhabitants in the area, you can easily do this. But this is something very much related with the stance of the local level authorities and also the mechanism, the working mechanism between the local and the national level authorities. So basically, I'll just briefly give you how the system works. Urban master plans are produced in local level by the greater municipality of Mardin, but the more regional level plan is prepared by the national level. So in a way, local authority has to follow the national level, the regional level plans. So there should be a consistency between two scales. And since the plans are prepared in the regional level without knowing what is going on in the local scale, it is not easy to produce responsive solutions. And once the upper scale level plan is approved, it is not easy to change it in the local level because we have to follow the regional level plans. For instance, in Mardin, this was a big problem because regional level plans was opening a really big amount of housing area, more than the existing housing stock in Mardin. This was something ridiculous when you think about the local level plan. And they wanted to change it. They wrote like official letters to the higher institution again. So all these kind of interactions between mechanisms between two institutions, two layers, creates the practical problems. And of course, there are some other problems also in the local level when they are preparing their master plans. For instance, a lack of human sources. If they don't have any urban planner or designer oriented technical experts in the planning team, it is not expected to see this kind of new ideas which are more responsive to climate conditions. And very interesting, there was only one planner in the urbanization section of the municipality. Only one, and she has 3 years experience. And others were engineers, electric engineers. And I'm not saying that engineers are not important for urban planning, but there is only one single person who is responsible for checking what this private company is doing in Ankara. And also it was same for the national level representative of the Ministry of Environment and Urbanization, because they are responsible for how to implement this national climate change action plan in the local level. And again, there is only one landscape architect who had no idea about how to reflect all these upper level strategies to local level. And he was saying that lack of examples is the most important problem because they don't know what to produce first, and the second is they don't know how to do it. And he's allowed himself to transfer all this huge document, the action plan, climate change action plan, to the local level. This is a big problem. There should be a small committee or maybe large committee who is working on this issue, because this seems like one of the major problems in the city because of the harsh climate.
Thank you. Any other comments or questions?
Okay.
Yeah, go ahead.
And I was wondering.
I think I managed. I was wondering how the picture changes when there is also the protected site, because there are so many registered buildings in the old town in Mardin. Mm-hmm. So does it play a role? And I think when you were doing the surveys, it must be the time of tourism influx. I mean, now we know that everything stopped in the region, but the tourism planning as well as, you know, protection of historic buildings, does it make any difference in your
research? Yes, it does. Yeah, thank you very much for this question. It does, and it has a really big impact. And while I was doing the research, the Mardin was candidate for UNESCO, and they wanted to tear down the buildings, the illegal buildings in the area, which doesn't match the local pattern, local or urban pattern of the area. And there was a new project, again, led by Toki, for the people who will be transferred from this area to a new zone. And again, Toki was saying that these buildings will be responsive to the local conditions and also climate. we don't know the outcomes yet, but as far as I know, the only difference from the prototype development for now is the height of the building. They will be like three stories apartments, but I don't know the technical details of the new proposal. But when I turn back to your question, yes, tourism planning and this UNESCO factor plays a significant role in terms of protecting climate responsive development typology in the city.
Can you elaborate more on the difference between the old town and the new, the contemporary site in terms of the architectural planning of the cities? Why do you think in the old town, in the vernacular you said, I think, mm-hmm. In that area it is much more easier to cool down the mm-hmm. houses? Is it related with the planning, inside planning, or you said that there are very narrow streets, maybe it is, you said, the wind corridors mm-hmm. they produce? And do you think they can, the new new planning might get idea from that old vernacular planning, city planning?
Well, thank you. I would like to turn back to this simplification of scales that I presented in the beginning. What I observed in the old town, I made this classification just to make it easy to understand, like architectural scale, street scale, neighborhood scale. These different scales constitute a whole in the city. So we can or we shouldn't design each scale individually. This is what is going on in Turkish urban implementations. Because planners decide about the plot and architects design the building, and in the end there is not a coherence between the street, between the way streets are planned or the plots are designed or the green areas are projected. But what is seen in the old town, everything is designed in a coherent way. For instance, starting from indoor experiences, when you go out from your house, you enter a transition zone between the street and the house. There is a courtyard, and then you go out from the house. You find yourself in the street, which gives you the feeling like the street is still a part of your house, like a transitionary zone between the public space and private space. And then from following the streets, you feel that you are going through different vessels of the city, again within the same comprehensive production. But if you look at the satellite map here, in the new town, you can't even say that the city has a macro form. The city doesn't have a macro form that holds all other channels and the small buildings inside or outside these channels. The city is spreading, so this is why we control, this is why we can see what we can observe in the heritage site. Heritage site provides more compact forms, including the vernacular architecture typologies and the streets, but the mean town presents more like partial developments. So perhaps the roles are decided before the construction, and then partially plots are developed in single spaces. You can see in the north, there is not any public service in the area, but there are some construction, just single buildings, even without an asphalt road. So this is why we cannot produce the same level of quality in the new town.
Thank you. Any other questions? Yes, please.
I thank you very much for your wonderful conference. Only I would be pleased to have printed document through the British Institute in Ankara, if possible. I would like to study extra because I am architect and study town planning in London, town planning department. I would be pleased if you so kind to give me all the print of your conference.
Of course, it's a pleasure. I can also share my PhD.
So. If it is possible.
Of course. Thank you.
Comments? The gentleman there.
Thank you, Enda, for a really interesting talk. You were presenting, there was quite a lot of stuff, comments about how people felt about the new town, how people in the old town felt about the new town. I was just quite interested in a bit more about how people in the new town feel about the old. You complicated it by saying about half of people have houses in both, so maybe aside from them, those who are left. And I was just quite interested, it seemed as if the ideas of modernity were like quite important to people's decisions, and I just wondered if that's true or not. Like, you know, to be sort of modern or to lead a modern style, you better to have an apartment with an air conditioning unit, you know, rather than live in a house with an outdoor toilet or something. I just wondered how like discourses of modernity, are they quite strong, are they quite powerful in people's housing behaviour, in driving people to choose these new apartments, or is that am I barking up the wrong tree? Is that not a factor?
No. This is true. The reason why I have highlighted the importance of thermal comfort in the old town is actually the unique characteristic of the site. But of course, when we think about people, the 50%, let's say, who prefers to live in the new town, they have some different priorities, I should say. For instance, the working class who came from different cities, they prefer to live in the new town because of the modern functions and the facilities that can easily reach. For instance, like even a single supermarket, there is not a supermarket in the old town. Still traditional way of bakkal works in the old town, but some people doesn't prefer to live in this condition. But my research is just focusing on the thermal comfort, but as you said, there are some other indicators which defines the quality of life. And thermal comfort is just one component of quality of life. There are some other components like accessibility to different functions like hospitals, education, and etc. So, for instance, some people doesn't want their children to walk to school, and there's no alternative in the old town because they had to walk since it's all pedestrianized, and people prefer to live in the old town just to send their children to school by service, by minibus. Yes, so I'm not saying that the only highlight is thermal comfort in the city, and most people try to go towards the old town. But as I said, there are some weaknesses in the old town too. But this doesn't mean that we can ask from the past to develop more responsive city in the new part. And on the other hand, there is not more space in the old town because the hill is already covered by the buildings. So they have to develop in the valley. Yeah, but the important thing is how to do it in the flat environment.
Thank you. Any other questions? Perhaps I can ask you a couple of questions and continue from that. You mentioned in the beginning to the questions of whether there are some legislative ground that allow implementation of these codes or the values. You mentioned a little bit why the new town is the way it is in a way, but we see that the contextual, from your study, the contextual and eco-social values actually produce a better environment that responds to the climate conditions. And it is our curiosity, as everyone's, that why this is not translated to the new town. And topology, as you found in your studies, one of the most significant factors that actually distinguishes the old town from the new town. And when we look at the topology, we see that the form, the floor, the number of the floor, the size, the inclusion of the open space, like with terraces and corsairs and so forth, there is a very distinct difference between the new town and the old town in terms of topology. So, did you get any other clues from your work on site? Why the topology is so different, and while in the old town people produce the space in such a eco-friendly way? Did you get any other clues about other than the ownership pattern and the inadequacy of the open space and so forth?
First of all, I should say that the new town is developed after the establishment of the Republic. So there was a big migration from rural areas to the urban site, and they had to develop very quickly. And the capacity of the subcontractors were not enough to catch this demand. Mm-hmm. And they had produced the buildings in the way that they produce in any city of the country. And this is the general story for all cities in Turkey. One of the main reasons why the contemporary development doesn't produce locally contextually oriented typologies. First is the time, and second is the human resource again, because it is easy to construct same prototype building. You don't need even an architect to do it, because if you have one single project, then you can just paste it in the city, in the plan. And also, I expect something to see from the national level housing authority, Turkey, to be like leader for finding some different typologies for different climatic regions in Turkey, because we have many different climates and many different lifestyles, and we develop same kind of Toki building in all climatic regions. Mm-hmm. You can see the same Toki building in the Black Sea region, where the main problem of city is flooding and rain, and you can see a similar building in Mardin, where the conditions are totally different. I know that they are trying to produce something new for different climatic regions, but I'm afraid it's too late now to do it. I mean, if we want to see the change in implementation, it should be derived from the national level authority first, and then we can expect from subcontractors to change their ongoing facilities. And when I talked to some subcontractors, it was by chance, it was not part of my plans. And they were saying me that they were asking why should we cover the cost of introducing new typologies. We are already doing this, and people show the demand to buy air conditioner buildings because they feel comfortable. So this is the answer, and it's very obvious because there is a reality called the economy. And there should be some initiatives from the government, I think, which gives more motivation to find some different typologies in different settings. And there are also some moral problems, which I also write in my research. Some people who doesn't have any right to plan, right in the planning system, but just because of their powerful conditions and powerful chairs, place the plans of the city, and this even small changes creates very big problem in the city. Mm-hmm. For instance, one night they can decide increasing the height of the buildings maybe from 5 to 10. And it is done by one single manager who are working in the ministry, in the Department of Urbanization. I'm not saying this in the Mardin case, but I got some clues from the interviews. Mm-hmm. Of course, I cannot explain all the details, mm-hmm. Which department was it or who was it. But there are some really moral issues, which I guess also in other cities as well. Because urban planning is very much related to production of land, and mm-hmm. which is very much related with the land value. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. And also, I understand that from your study, if we want to be responsive to climate change, then we have to understand the context first to be able to produce climate condition sensitive solutions. Let's say we have a team in our municipality, a good group of planners and sociologists and some from ecologists and so forth, and they want to understand what the context has produced in the past. And for them to be able to conduct such a big study is almost impossible. What would you give as a practical advice to implementers, to planners, and decision makers from this study, how they can really do very quickly, conduct such a study very quickly, and translate that into a plan, mm-hmm. integrate that into your plan making.
Yes, yeah, as you said, this is a big project which mm-hmm. took like 3 years to conduct. And also, this is an extreme case because presence of urban heritage sites provide me to conduct a comparison research, and it may not happen in some other regions because of non-existence of the past development. But still, learning from the past, I think, is the key. It doesn't have to be something tangible that in the level that we see in the heritage site. But still, the past experiences and the people, the local people who are experiencing these problems, are, I think, the key issues that needs to be involved in the future planning of the city. Mm-hmm. And the easiest way of doing this is the participation. Of course, there are some different ways of participating, but in your case, let's say we have some a group of experts who are really a volunteer to mm-hmm. understand the local context. We don't need long processes mm-hmm. to explore the local level requirements and also mm-hmm. to understand the local characteristics. This can be done with like participatory workshops or meetings, a series of meetings, which allows us to produce technical knowledge together with the social knowledge, with the local stakeholders and local people. Mm-hmm. So, learning from past, again, I think the key issue here, which I'm also trying to conduct in Lexi region, because in Lexi region there is no heritage site that I can learn from past, but there is past of the urban development. There are some past plans and also people who has been living there for long years and their experiences. And this is now I'm trying to learn and get some information mm-hmm. from them.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Is there anyone who would like to comment on that? This it was quite striking to me too, like the last extract that you shared about the woman that who called his life is primitive, and then called the other one is contemporary. And we can sense that from other quotations too, in a way, that there is always this us and them kind of distinction, separation, or in a way segregation, I should say. If perhaps we see the space production as a social process, then everyone has a responsibility. Then we kind of expect that decision makers or implementers have to do this and that, but how about citizens? they are the ones who should also take the responsibility of their past and and the transformation of the space in the current time. So there is a lot that everyone probably have to feel and take the responsibility of their future. And that involves, of course, the awareness and consciousness and you know, being informed aspects. So there's a lot of things that we can talk. But the active citizenship point of view becomes very important in that too, and how they demand to become a part of the planning process in a way, rather than expecting others to do it for them. So. This will be my last comment too, so for this talk. But thank you so much again for this great work and sharing that with us and giving really a perspective that we can do something for climate change. So thank you for coming too.
So a big applause to all for presenting the discussant, and let me invite you to a small reception outside, which we can actually continue discussing. Thank you very much.
Thank you.